Good morning, everyone. If we can, I'd like to get ourselves started. Welcome to the Majority Policy Committee hearing today. We are proud to be here in your lovely hamlet. I'm Representative Kerry Benninghoff out of Center in Mifflin Counties, which is the center of state. And we like to brag the home of the Nittany Lions. We are here to discuss an important issue. As you can imagine, the legislature gets all kinds of issues to deal with. And today has to do with property rights and access to burial sites. This issue is not unique to Berks County. As a former county coroner, I have dealt with this in the past in multiple levels. As our population continues to age, as well as our country, we find perpetual care in a lot of our cemeteries a very difficult task as communities. A lot of them privately owned or end up in private ownership, and others fall into the responsibility of townships and boroughs, and sadly, many of them have little to no perpetual care plans, and therefore a lot of money is not available to help take care of them. My goal, and I believe this is the goal of our committee, is to try to do some fact-finding today to get a better comprehension of the severity of your issue here locally, as well as it plays on some of the ones that are happening across other parts of the state. And hopefully we can see if there's any kind of legislative solutions, and we'll go on from there. Before we begin formal testimony, I'm going to ask Representative Gillen, who was gracious enough to host us here in your beautiful county, to give a few remarks. And then I'm going to ask the members from my left to right to actually, maybe I'll do that first. If the members just introduce themselves and where they're from, we'll have Representative Gillen give a couple opening remarks, and then we'll proceed with our testifiers on panel one. Thank you.
Barry Joswiak, Berks County, 5th District.
Representative Stan Saylor, York County, 94th District.
Jerry Knowles, 124th District, which includes portions of Berks, Schuylkill, and Carbon County.
Tim Hennessy, the 26th District, just east of here, a couple miles east.
Hi, good morning. Brian Cutler, 100th District, Southern Lancaster County.
And I am State Representative Mark Gillen, representing Southern Berks County and Northern Lancaster Counties. Thank you all for being here, and just as a reminder, you see a lot of cameras around here. Some of them are TV news, some of them have been contracted to be here, and then we have State House cameras as well. So just be cognizant of that, that this is all being recorded. May I approach this from a slightly different vantage point, if I could, that as of a dad, a husband, a brother, a son, I think of my own dad, who is a World War II aviator. He's been gone now for 30 years, and certainly we would fully expect, and you would fully expect, that you would be able to visit the grave of your dad, like I visit the grave of my dad. He was orphaned in Brooklyn and rose up as a teenager and decided he wanted to serve his country after Pearl Harbor, and he enlisted in the Navy and was in a machine gun tear of a torpedo plane. And I don't think there's going to be any significant disagreement in this room that our family and I, as his son, should have the opportunity to visit that gravesite, regardless of where he's buried. Little bit emotional. I have a younger brother who passed away, and I know we're going to hear some testimony from our distinguished friends at the front table. And it's been a long time since he died, but I want for you what my family is able to enjoy and memorialize and stand by that graveside. And I would hope, and I just found out a family member is seriously ill, I would hope that in every case we could collectively acknowledge that fundamental right. May I hasten to add, there are property rights that we're all conscious of in the Commonwealth of Pennsylvania and the United States of America, and that's certainly a right of exclusion. Without getting into this too deeply, the absolute right of exclusion ends at the cemetery gate. and that we should have the opportunity as citizens of the Commonwealth to visit, to memorialize, to pray, to remember. I keep on the desk of my office a picture of Ricky's grave, and I know the Millers are going to have more to say about this. A three-year-old. I have a three-year-old at home. A three-year-old whose grave they cherish and they memorialize and they want to visit. And as you can see by the gravestone, this is not some Civil War-era grave. This is more contemporary. And later on, we'll hear from the Hams relative to that empty spot on the tombstone that's waiting to be engraved. And if you go to this cemetery, you'll indeed see locally older graves, but you're going to see more contemporary graves. And so when you think about what's at stake here in this community, recognize that there are similar situations around the Commonwealth, and I'm so pleased that the policy chair, Representative Benninghoff, has been willing to take this issue on. So thank you, and I'll turn the microphone back over to Chairman Benninghoff.
Thank you, Mark. And again, we appreciate the invitation. Beautiful area. For our panel, if you want, we can have all of you give your comments and then open up to members rather than having members ask questions individually. So today we have William Miller, Hazel Hamm, Kathy Shepard, Vicki Newmaker, thank you, Don Jacobs, and I don't know if there's somebody in addition from American Legion Post 537, or are you with them, Don? Very good. Well, I generally go ladies first, so I don't know if we just want to go left to right instead, and we'll kind of skip over that. Bill, if you want to start, and we'll just go from your left on to Mr. Jacobs. Nope. Just sit there, and as long as the microphone's close enough, because this is being taped by the House video crew for members in the legislature that are not able to be here, and they will be able to review this later. So if you see us moving your forward, just pull the microphones closer to you. If you need to take a break in the middle of your testimony, feel free to do that. Thank you.
Well, what started our problems is the want of a wife to be buried next to her son. The promises that she made him when he passed. And then, you know, we're told we can't. We're told no trespassing. I was confronted by policemen. They called on me, even though my grandson and I, we mowed it for like 7 years because it was neglected. 7 years, we and our other members of the family would jump in and mow and keep it clean because we couldn't stand to watch it like it was. We didn't know, didn't care, it was sold or resold. It was sold several times before they finally got a hold of it, the Dovins family. Nobody else gave us a problem. It's only because of me and mine, what I own. And that day that the police were called, I was told I was a pain in the ass. Why? Well, because the policeman had to be called, I was trespassing. Yet when I was mowing it, up until the last 6 months ago, it was perfectly fine. I was doing it for free. Me and the grandson, I was teaching him respect. Now these people trash respect because they have none. The dead are there. They're ours. They're not their property. It's not real estate. It's our hearts laying there waiting. The suffering my wife has to go through because of this, it was hard enough to bury him. And now it's hard enough to watch fighting over him. We watched several other people buried there at the time the Dovins started to own it in 2010. They tried to block a funeral of my wife's aunt, who's buried, Louise Shepherd, who's buried beside her veteran husband. Gonna bring that up several times. And then, my father-in-law's buried there, which is, I'm the second husband of this marriage. Ricky was a Danzeisen, whose his father was a vet, and his ashes were denied burial there near his son. And, that's you know, there was no protection for veterans. There is now none yet. Oh, well, they'll put flags on. And then we were told just recently that, like today, that a couple days ago, oh, the Dovins claimed that they were vandalized and the flags were all broken. Can you give us more? And yet, oh, our family members were the ones that put the flags on. I was told that today, too. And it's, you know, there was several funerals that they could not block because it's like the hearse is there. You can't stop a funeral. And then, you know, we had to go the route of getting a lawyer because we were called into a court and we're named in a suit to stay away, to turn our back. That won't happen. Whether I'm arrested or not, I don't care. Because as far as I know, the dead own it. They're there. That's their final resting spot. It's not property. It's not something you can play with and kick people in the face who want to bury and watch and look at their dead ones, their friends. We've had friends that are veterans that are buried there. We worked with Hank and Lil Hewitt. I mowed around their headstones in trim. Oh, and I was ridiculed by a policeman. Say, well, you know, we won't arrest you now. The district attorney said you shouldn't. And we were ridiculed. Well, then you can go there and do whatever you want. And these people walking here, they're our friends. They let us park behind a cemetery on their property so that we wouldn't be arrested or our cars wouldn't be towed for visiting a cemetery. Kindness of strangers. We've had the neighbor across the street ask me, can you mow it for Memorial Day? People want to visit. Say, yeah, I come out of the hospital with a kidney stone, but we'll make sure we mow it. So it was support of the people around the cemetery and not the people that own the cemetery. Now, I don't know in the state of Pennsylvania how you could own a cemetery, but they own the building. That's fine. I don't care what they do with that. But you don't own my dead. I said that when right in front of the policeman when I was a pain in the ass. You do not own my dead. You cannot. We say no. We will visit. No matter what happens in the court, you just have to feed me in jail, which is going to be very expensive, I promise. It's just a hard problem. I don't understand how this can get this far. And the township was of no help. We can't do nothing. We're afraid. It's going to cost us money. Well, it cost us money, and we have little of it. But even this morning, the wife is in tears, hoping that this can be resolved so she can be buried beside her son. Now, I don't know what heartless, cruel, I'd like to say other words, but this is the way our country's turning. No respect for anything, let alone the dead. If there was a dead policeman laying in there, I'm sure there'd be more respect given. But there are dead veterans. 1861, on up through World War I, World War II, I've seen all the numbers. I see the flags. I can tell who's who. But, you know, we had a president that consecrated a grave site in Gettysburg for the veterans of that war, Civil War. We have Civil War vets buried here. Why does not it encompass the whole state where there is a Civil War veteran buried? I don't know. These little shires and outside places like this is too far from public eye, maybe? I don't know. But all we did was ask for help. I called everybody I could find in the phone book after they tried to arrest me or claimed or threatened. Now, if you were threatened, wouldn't you feel like you were going to be arrested? It's like if somebody's going to hold a gun to you and threaten to shoot you, don't you think you might? But, you know, we're just tired. We have to fight all the time. Wasn't it a fight enough to put him in the ground? And now we have to suffer again? The sadness is this country is country. This is not some, this is America. It shouldn't happen to each other. We have veterans in our family too, so it shouldn't happen to us. I don't know what more to say, other than please help. Thank you.
If you're comfortable, you can pull the microphone over if you want to share a few thoughts of your own.
Okay. I'm Hazel Ham, and about 30 years ago, we had a church that is now Rock Church, but it was Rock Baptist Church, and it was, we were members of that church. It is an active church, and after my little grandson, Ricky, passed away, my husband and I decided we wanted to be buried there too. So we went and bought two plots. And a little over 20 years ago, I buried him there. And I bought a headstone with both our names on it and our birthday. And now we're told that I can't be buried there. I think that's cruel. I have that right to be buried there. And I also have two brothers and a sister-in-law buried there. And my one daughter bought four plots. My other daughter bought two plots, which now they planted a tree on her plot, big tree. And I don't think that's right. And my nephew bought two plots. And we own a lot. We paid for that. We have receipts for it. And I think we own that ground where we're to be buried, and I think we should be buried there, and I think they should come to the point to realize that it's not their ground, it's our ground that we paid for. And I just wanted to let you know that I will be fighting for it. Like I said, I want to be buried with my husband and grandson. My one brother was a veteran, and my other brother, he's buried there too. But I just don't like it how they're doing us. I'm a Christian person, and I believe in right and right, but I don't think it's right that they treat us like that. I was told that a cemetery was not to be sold. They could sell plots, but not a cemetery, and I just don't think that's right.
Thank you, Mrs. Ham. Ricky's got a good, strong grandmother. We appreciate your testimony. Ms. Shepherd?
My name is Kathy Shepherd. I am here to try to help my mom, whose name is Nina Pruitt. She is 89 years old, and she's not in the best of health. She really isn't. And she and my mom and my dad brought grave plots July 26, 2002. My father passed away October the 14th, 2004, and was buried at the Rock Cemetery Church there. He was a veteran of World War II and the Korean War. He was awarded two Purple Hearts and a Bronze Star. And I'm sorry. My parents were married for 53 years, and they loved each other so very much. And my mom's wishes are to be buried beside my dad, which they brought the plots together, and, you know, and they want to be side by side like they were for 53 years. And if this lawsuit goes through, she has seven children. She has 23 grandchildren, 37 great-grandchildren, and four great-great-grandchildren who will not be able to visit my dad's grave. And My father-in-law, Ray Shepherd, is buried there also. That's Hazel's brother. And he was buried there, and he has four sons. He has two great-grandchildren. He has 29 grandchildren and six great-great-grandchildren. And, you know, to deny them the right to visit their grandfather's grave, that it just is not right. I'm sorry, it isn't. My husband's uncle is buried there. He is a veteran. His name is Willard B. Shepherd. And he passed away March 30th in 1996. He was also a veteran of World War II. And he was awarded the Purple Heart and a Bronze Star. And he has, and his wife, who is buried there after the Dovans bought the property. And he has five children and many grandchildren. And my brother, John and Joyce Layton, have great plots there also. My brother's in the hospital right now, real bad. And the new owners of the cemetery planted the tree on their grave, which is not right or called for. My brother-in-law, Jerry, and his wife, Laura Shepherd, have purchased plots at that lot at the cemetery too on September the 9th, 1994, and are also being told that they're not allowed to be buried there. This is a major worry for my brother-in-law right now, but due to his wife's health condition right now, there are plots that were sold before the new owners purchased this property of November the 8th of 2010. In my belief, they should be grandfathered into this to be buried with their loved ones. And, you know, the family should be able to visit the graves in peace without being videotaped or pictures taken of them every time. Our family is of the Southern heritage, I'm sure you can tell. In the South, we are taught from little on up to take great pride in taking care of our family's graves. We are taught to respect and honor of our ancestors by upkeeping the graveyards. We have a holiday in the South. It is called Decoration, in honor of these traditions. On this day, we have church services in the graveyards, as well as putting flags and flowers on our family's graves. We traveled from Pennsylvania to Virginia 475 miles every year to honor my husband's mom's grave and his grandparents and uncles. And you know, it's an honor for us to do this. And if this law doesn't go through, will be declined the right to uphold our ways and pass it on down to our grandchildren. When the owners of the cemetery purchased the cemetery, our family was very dishonored by the upkeep of the property. We would go and find the graves covered in weeds up to your knees. Couldn't even see the grave. The tombstones. And we went to the township to report this. They said they would notify the Dovans. Then they told us they wouldn't get involved. Several of the family reported this, so we called the family and talked to them. and we went up there and we mowed and weed-eated and cleaned up the grave. After several of these trips doing this, Bill Miller took over this for us. We all chipped in and helped him with the expenses of doing this, and his grandson, Damon, helped him every time. This is the first year that we didn't have to take care of this property. During this process, the owners put up no trespassing signs, and they sued us. The sue was basically that we exhume our relatives and rebury them or forfeit our right to visit the graves. As you can imagine, this is a hardship on our friends and family who have loved ones there. A lot of us cannot emotionally conceive this, and it is putting a lot of stress on our loved ones. My dear mom cries herself to sleep night after night because of this. And I just want something to be done so that we can visit and with respect the way that we respect our loved ones. And my dad was so particular with his yard and his flowers and stuff. And we tried to keep his grave the way he would like it. So in conclusion, I thank you for taking time to listen to me. And hopefully this can be worked out, that the promised graves can be honored, and that we can continue our traditions of visiting our loved ones' graves. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Kathy. It's admirable, your dedication and your honor to your family. What makes America a great country. We appreciate your testimony.
Thank you.
Vicki, when you're comfortable.
Well, this is a little harder than I thought it was going to be after sitting here hearing the heart-wrenching stories of everybody going before me and seeing the tears of up above. But this one's for you, Dad. My name's Vicki Nunemaker. I've been coming to visit my father, Ray Shepherd, in his final resting place for 10 years now. He picked this plot out where he wanted to be buried and paid for it himself. I didn't. I'm now being told if I want to visit him, I need to exhume his body and move him somewhere else. Somewhere where he didn't pick. I'm not doing that. I don't think there's anybody in this room that would do that. We have never had a problem with this cemetery when Tracy Jones owned the property. The Dovins purchased it back in 2010, and that's when all the problems started. No trespassing and private property signs were posted. Fences were put up to keep us out, and the police were called when we went on the property. We have always been able to come and visit whenever we wanted to, place flowers on the graves, and be buried in the plots we purchased until the Dovins purchased this. Louise Shepherd was the last to be buried in this cemetery of our family. I guess she was very lucky to be buried next to her husband like she wanted to, because everybody else that has plots here, bought and paid for, are being denied to be buried next to their loved ones, even those who already have their names on the tombstones already. How does anybody just buy a cemetery and not do the research that people still come to visit, and it is an active cemetery? This is like buying a house next to an airport and complaining about the noise. If you don't want people on your property, then you just don't buy a cemetery. We're not asking for much. We never have, none of us. We do not want to cause any problems. The Dovins say we have cast them in a negative light with taking this situation that we are in to the local news stations, posting this on Facebook, and putting it in the newspapers. I think everybody has a right to know what's been going on, and I will keep letting everybody know what's going on. We have a lot of support from the community about this. Nobody can believe that they've been getting away with what they're trying to do. Where is their family buried? What if someone told them they couldn't visit their family that had passed away? What would they do? What if someone took pictures and videos of them every time they went to visit? I don't think they would keep quiet about it. Barb Miller made a promise to her little boy, Ricky, that she would always come to visit and be with him. She did that faithfully every Sunday until just recently when she told she could not do this anymore and would be prosecuted if she did so. She has done this for many, many years. That breaks my heart. Hazel Hamm wants to be buried in the plot that she purchased many years ago with her husband. She already has her name on the tombstone and has for many years. The Dovins are denying her this. Nina Pruitt wants to be buried in the plot that she purchased many years ago with her husband. The Dovins are denying her of this. The Dovins planted a tree in John and Joyce Layton's burial spot. In my opinion, they did that out of spite. If anybody in here knew my father, he would always say, if something's not right, you have to raise a little hell to make it right. I guess that's what you could say I'm going to do. It's not that hard to just do the right thing. Thank you for your time, and I appreciate everybody being here.
Thank you, Vicki. I'm sure Father's proud.
Thank you.
Mr. Jacobs, and are you here on behalf of the American Legion?
Or? Yes, sir, I am.
Thank you. We are joined by one of our other members, Representative Stevens, out of Southeast. Thank you, Todd, for joining us.
You have to excuse me. I was kind of hoping the folks to my right would just keep talking all morning, and you'd never get to me.
From your heart.
My name is Don Jacobs. I'm here representing the Colonel Jacob Morgan, Post 537 of the American Legion. I grew up in Joanna, attended Rock Church Vacation Bible School. My dad was a veteran of World War II. He was also a past commander of Colonel Jacob Morgan Legion Post, as were two of my brothers, including my brother Roger back here, who was involved in the dispute this past Memorial Day, which I understand was resolved somewhat satisfactorily, although that was just one situation, certainly nothing like the folks to my right. Up until this past June, I was the financial officer of that Legion Post. Four brothers. Four other brothers who were also members there. As I said, my dad was past commander. My brother Barry was past commander, and Roger is now past commander. My four brothers and I were all either in the Marine Corps or the Army. I tell people that there were five of us. Three were in the Marines and three were in the Army. I said, gee, your math's not too good. My youngest brother was in both the Marines and the Army. There's a special relationship among people who serve or have served in the military. As a matter of fact, on Thursday morning, I'll be leaving for Columbus, Ohio for my Army reunion. Meet some people again. Excuse me. Meet some people again who I haven't seen mostly in a year, but whom I never knew before July 5th of 1966. Spent 15 months in Vietnam with these folks for varying lengths of time. We get together to drink some beer and tell the same lies we've been telling for 20 years that our wives are tired of hearing. Every time we leave, my wife said, you know, the story was a little different last year. And I said, well, I can't remember all the details at my age. All we want to do is pay our respects to the veterans that are interred in the Rock, what I know is the Rock Church Cemetery. Civil War veterans, World War I veterans, World War II veterans. As I said, there was an arrangement worked out this past Memorial Day with my brother Roger back here, who, as I said, was the post commander at that time, with the owners of the property. We would hope that this legislation, excuse me, would address this on an ongoing basis, not just for the Legion Post and for veterans, but also obviously, even more importantly, for the folks to my right and others who have relatives buried there. You have to pardon me, I'm kind of an emotional guy. When we had dogs, my wife always had to take them to the vet. I guess she was tougher than I was, than I am, at any rate. I understand that there's a liability issue involved with entering somebody else's property, and as a property owner, I and others, folks in this room, I'm sure, are concerned with those issues. There are things like attractive nuisances, which if you have a farm pond, which I do, you're concerned about because a kid walking down the road might be attracted to that attractive nuisance. And I guess a cemetery could be construed to be an attractive nuisance, although that's certainly an awkward choice of words at best. But I'm sure that liability issue either can or I should say will be or can be addressed by the legislation if it's not already addressed in existing legislation. I understand from Representative Gillen that there actually is law already in effect which allows a veteran organization to enter cemeteries at around Memorial Day to place flags and so forth, although it's also my understanding that Berks County has not enforced those provisions with respect to this particular issue. If I'm misstating the facts, I appreciate, I apologize, but those are the facts as I understand them. All we at the American Legion Post 537, which I've always referred to as the Joanna Legion, since that's where it's located, although most people refer to it as the Morgantown Legion. Excuse me again. All we want is the opportunity to place flags, maintain those flags, and pay our respects to all the veterans who have gone before us. And who have honorably served our country, which we all love. Thank you very much, and again, I apologize for my somewhat emotional presentation.
Thank you, Mr. Jacobs, on behalf of yourself and for the American Legion post that you represent. Members to my left, we'll start with Representative Stan Saylor and then Representative Jerry Knowles for questions. If you want to address them to who you want to answer a question, that'd be helpful.
I'm not, I don't recall exactly who has talked. I know a number of you already have markers with your names on, with dates yet to be filled in, I guess. Are there any of you that testified, and again, I can't remember this as we went through the testimony, that at this point do not have markers, but have receipts of sales of lots? I figure if you have a marker there, that's kind of your receipt for sure.
I just hope and pray that you guys can help us keep our plots to be buried in, because we paid for them and they belong to us, not her. She can have the rest of the ground. I know she can't sell a cemetery, but she can sell plots, and that's, I know it's against the law. But I do hope that you guys, and God's grace, will help us get and keep our plots to be buried in, because that's where I want to be buried. And I think it's going to be soon. I've not that down.
Have any of you had direct talks, not through attorneys, but direct talks early on in the process with the Dovens?
I'm sorry.
Have you had direct face-to-face discussions with the owners, the current owners, at any time?
We've asked to be buried there, and they said, no comment. You talk to my lawyer. That's all they would say to us. They wouldn't say a word to us.
Well, they'd run from us. Channel 69 News and Channel 8 News did different. They were out there. And Channel 8 actually had to run down to Dovens because they were out taking pictures, and then they run from them, and they wouldn't talk to them. Now, back when we mowed, like I said, me and my grandson, we'd face-to-face with the Dovens, and they were perfectly happy that we were mowing it for free. But then something changed. I don't know what. Then we were ordered off the property. I got a phone call at work from the wife saying that they called the house saying, asking if you were on the property, you're trespassing. I said, well, they know I was on the property. We mowed it. And then I called the police and said, yeah, they called the police on you, and you were to stay off the property. It was private property and trespassing. I said, you know, I'm not going to do that.
So there is no direct incident that you know of for a reason why they may have changed their attitude about anything?
We don't know that, if there is. They haven't talked to us. They won't talk to us at all. If they would just come face to face and explain why they are doing this to us, we might could understand it better. But we bought them plots on that ground before they ever bought that place, and it's ours. And I just hope and pray you guys can do something that we can be buried there and visit our loved ones. I have several loved ones. I had a son that was in Vietnam for over a year fighting for justice, and I hope justice will be done.
Okay, thank you. The only comment I have to say for all of you, God bless you. I have never, you know, again, unless there's some evidence out there, something that a reason that none of us have heard, and I have a feeling will not heard. This is one of the most atrocious things I've ever heard. And I have been involved with appraising cemeteries in the past, many years ago, and things like that. I have never heard of anything in this state like this. And I could say a few other things, but I'm just going to say, God bless you, and I hope the things can be worked out in a very positive light for you and your families. Thank you.
Before going to the next question, I had actually two things I wanted to ask. Maybe you can help frame things. This was sold in 2010. One, does anybody know the purchase price? Two, was it done publicly? And three, who was it purchased from?
Well, it was a public auction, and $85,000 was the price named to me. Tracy Jones was the auctioneer, and Dovens bought it. Now, before, there was a private deal with Tracy Jones and the then owner's son. Harvey Kurtz was the man who owned it at the time after the church passed it to him. His son, Titus, had sold it to Tracy Jones for like $30,000, and then Tracy Jones renovated the building, rented out offices for a time, and we had no trouble with him. He upkept the cemetery. When I called him later, he said, yeah, I had somebody mowing it, and if I'd have known that you would do it for free, I would have asked you. But, you know, that's all we know, you know, from the auction papers, because I was busy with my wife. She had streptococcal pneumonia, and she was in Reading Hospital for a month. So I didn't have time to come down and look. It was kind of a surprise to us. It showed up in the paper. So that's all we know.
Okay, again, sale price $85,000. It was done at a public auction, and it was bought from another previous private owner, which originally purchased it from the church.
Right.
Thank you. Representative Jerry Knowles and Representative Joswiak. Thank you for that clarification.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. I've been involved in government for 30 years, and the only way that this can be described is heartless insanity. I have never in my life heard of something like this, and I can't imagine anybody putting you folks through the pain that you're being put through, and we need to do something to help you resolve this, whether it be being certain that current law is, that they obey the current laws, or maybe there's new legislation such as what Representative Gillen has floated. Is there any, Mr. Chairman, I guess this would be for you, is there anyone here from the Dobbins family that's going to testify on the second panel? Do we have anybody?
No, sir.
They're the people that I'd like to talk to.
They're under litigation right now. So right now we're just trying to get some facts
about okay.
what's happening.
Well, very, very quickly, I don't understand how two people can own the same property. At some point in time, they sold you those lots, whether it be for four people or six people or whatever. I always thought when you purchased the cemetery lot that was your lot, that was your property. So did they like buy a house or a building and the cemetery came with it? Is that what happened here? Okay, but are they, I mean, there are a variety of people then who I would think would own various lots. So are they denying you access to the cemetery because you have to travel over their property to get to the cemetery?
No, it's right along a public highway, right past Twin Valley School, and it's a main road, state road, and you just walk across the driveway. It was an old church, so there's an ample parking spot, and then the graveyard and the building, and that's it. It's only like 0.7 of an acre. It's not even a full acre.
My dad's grave is the first one almost beside of the driveway. My mom has a plot right beside of it. And my brother, John, who is a Navy veteran, and his wife have a plot right beside of them. And then it goes on back to the plots that are in question.
When you purchased the lots, was there any type of agreement? Was there a document that you were given? And was there any type of a perpetual care? Was there anything of that nature involved in the transaction?
No, because Harvey Kurtz, who also went to that church, and at the time he, according to his son, he loved that place. He willingly took care of it. So we would give him money after to help with gas and whatever, because they just took care of it.
Right.
And then when he died, then, you know, that's where we are today.
The litigation is taking place. Is it litigation that is being done to try to resolve the issue, or is it litigation to that this is my property and you can't come on it.
That's pretty much it.
Pretty much it.
They want us off. They want us out. You can move your dead. Leave.
Leave. I couldn't bear to put my mother through that again. It was hard enough to bury my dad and my father-in-law the first time. It would be so hard to watch that to have my mom again.
And not to mention my wife with her. Right.
Yeah.
It would kill her.
And it would Hazel, too.
May I say something?
Sure. At the last township meeting, when we brought this issue to the township meeting to see if they could help us, we were told that we would not be arrested by any of the police in the district for going on that property, but they couldn't tell us for how long they would be able to do that. We were also told the reason they don't want us on the property, the Dovins, is they're afraid we're going to go on the property and we're going to fall down and we're going to sue them. That's their whole issue.
Heartless insanity. Thank you, Mr. Chairman.
Representative Joswiak, then Representative Hennessy.
First of all, I'd like to thank you all for your testimony.
We could put flowers on the grave at 3 o'clock. By the time he come home from work, they would take it off. Every day they would do that. We'd put the flowers on, they would take them right off. I don't know what they did with them, but we had bought the flowers and put them on.
Thank you. Thank you for your testimony. It's very emotional, very moving, and I'm concerned about this very much so. I'm really surprised. I have 26 years as a state police officer and 12 years as a sheriff of Berks County, and I've never, ever heard of an incident like this. I've heard of boundary arguments, but never something with a graveyard. And I know there's roads that were trying to be put in it from time to time. Because the cemetery was there, they couldn't put the road in. I have a couple of questions. How far is the road from the actual cemetery? I mean, we have some photographs here, and it looks like it's a slight distance.
Just a couple steps.
I can't tell the distance, though.
It's just a couple steps from the road. It's not very far. You park right alongside, and within 5 feet, you're on the cemetery property.
Oh, it's that close, okay. Mm-hmm. And also, is there a parking area for if you go there, or do you just pull onto the people's property and park anywhere?
Pull along the road because they wired off the property so that we could just barely walk on it.
Don't trespass it, sounds like.
Okay. I also, in the photographs that we have here, there seems to be a stone building, and there's also looks like a pole building. And then I don't know if it's across the street. It appears to be a house. Is there these people that own this property? Do they live across the street from this? The same property?
No, the people that have the pole barn are actually the friends of ours that allow us to park there so we won't get in trouble. And the building is an old stone building. It was the old church, and 1871 is the marker on the building. So that's about all that goes with that property is that building and, well, the ground, which is very little ground. 0.7 of an acre is not even a full acre. And I don't know how in Pennsylvania they were allowed to sell it so small without having more acreage for a building.
So the pole, the picture we have of this, let's say a gray or white pole building, that's not on the property, that's the neighbor's property.
No, it's
allowing
the neighbor's
you to park,
behind.
And that's just about adjacent to the cemetery.
Yes. Mm-hmm.
Okay. What's the status of the lawsuit right now?
Well, pretty much the lawyer's waiting to find out what is going on here with this panel and the fact that they could not serve everybody yet, so they're kind of holding off until all members of the lawsuit that was named are served, plus putting it in the paper for all the people that have family members there that are buried there that we bumped into and talked to that aren't named in the lawsuit. Anybody concerned is what the terminology might be. Mm-hmm. And they have no money. They can't fight either.
Well, I'd just like to make a couple comments. I want to thank Representative Gillen for bringing this to our attention. I'm living here in Berks County. I saw the first story in the newspaper, and I sit right beside Mark on the floor, and we talked about this, and we couldn't believe this was actually taking place. I also want to say the police here have used good discretion in not arresting people and trying to see if this can be worked out. They're in a tough spot because they must enforce the law, but they also need to use common sense. So accolades to the police department as well. And I think what we will do after this hearing, I'm really interested in hearing from the graveyard preservation people in the next panel, because they deal with all the graveyards, and I'd like to see what they have to say about this, and also the Cemetery and Cremation Associations. So that's all my comments are, Mr. Chairman. Thank you.
Thank you, Representative Joswiak. Representative Gillen, myself. I'm sorry, Representative Hennessy, myself, then Representative Gillen.
No, thank you, Mr. Chairman. Members, if you take a look, the pictures that you have in front of you, I took those some time ago. The brownstone is the brownstone building is the church. You can see the white or the stone wall in the back, which is stuccoed and painted white. That frames the far borders of the cemetery. And there are other photos in this grouping where you can see it's obvious that these are headstones for the cemetery. The white building that Mr. Miller was talking about that's not on the church property, but it borders the church property to the east. But excuse me, by the way, the property that we're talking about is really about 2 miles from here, just up behind the Twin Valley High School campus, which is close by. This has been a heartbreaking situation for so many people, the relatives and the friends of the people who are buried there. And when we took it first to our house legal staff, they indicated it was going to have to be resolved as a matter of contract law or property law. And that's where it's headed now, because the Dovins have filed what's called a quiet title action, I think, in the in Berks County Court. Does anybody have a copy of the lawsuit that was filed so that we could reproduce it, photocopy it, and get it to the members? Okay, if you could do that, we'll get copies, and then I'll get the original back to you.
I thought that I also faxed to Mark Gillen that particular lawsuit paper.
I have a copy.
Okay. Can I ask a question?
Yes, ma'am.
If you've already bought the plots, how can they sell the cemetery, which we've already bought and paid for the plots? How can they sell that?
I think that's a matter of legal interpretation. Some people would say that when you buy a cemetery plot, that the church owns the ground, but what you've bought is the right to be buried in that cemetery. And implicit in that is the right to be able to live out or have your family live out the rest of their lives knowing that you're not going to be disturbed in that cemetery. It was surprising to me when I talked to our legal staff that we don't seem to have any specific statutes on the books that say that basically put that into words. And that's what Representative Gillen's trying to do, to create a situation under the law that people who purchase this, these kind of properties, and clearly when you look at the photographs, the headstones are there, the markers are there. The most recent picture that I have, somebody had given me one that indicated a burial in 2010. So it was an active cemetery at the time that it was purchased. Anybody who would even just cast their eyes on the property would know that it's a cemetery and know that they were taking subject to it. Generally in the law, when you buy a building, if you've leased part of it out, you have to take subject to the rights of the tenant. And you know, you just can't come in and evict people by purchasing a building, and they don't lose their rights in occupying that building or part of the building because it's held by a new owner. And that's what we're trying to address in this legislation, that the rights that the families would have for the cemetery would continue regardless of who the owners the subsequent owners would be. I have a couple of questions that I'd like to ask. Yes, Mr. Jacobs.
For the record, I am not an attorney, but okay. I've been involved with a number of real estate auctions, and what is clearly in every instance in which I've been involved, it's stated at the beginning of the auction is that the property is sold as is, where is subject to all the warts, et cetera, which are associated with the property. And I know Tracy Jones personally. He's the auctioneer who owned that property and conducted the auction. He conducted some auctions for me of real estate. That statement is always made at the beginning. Do your investigation. They're making no reps and warranties with respect to anything other than clear title. So clearly anybody who bid on that property, I suspect, was told in advance that it was subject to anything that happened in the past and anything that goes into the future as far as contract. So, again, I am not an attorney, but I have been involved with a number of real estate auctions.
I agree with your relating how public auctions are generally sold. And by the way, you don't need to be an attorney to look at land and see headstones from centuries ago and find out and come to the conclusion that you're buying a cemetery. It just it defies any kind of common sense to think that somebody didn't know that they were buying a cemetery when you see all the headstones popping up. Although from the newspaper articles, I understand that's one of the allegations in the complaint, that they weren't aware that this was a cemetery that they were buying. Mr. Jacobs, you'd mentioned there was a dispute on Memorial Day of 2016. Could you just tell the panel what kind of a dispute was?
The American Legion is involved in making sure that there are flags on veterans' graves for Memorial Day. Actually, my brother, Roger, who, as I said, was the post commander at that time, was personally involved in discussions with the Dobins with respect to initially not being allowed access and then working out some kind of a temporary arrangement. So if you'd like to speak to him, please do so. But my understanding of what happened was that initially they were told, the Legion, were told basically stay off the property, and then apparently the daughter of the Dobins had some discussions with my brother, and they worked something out that, at least for this past Memorial Day, they could enter the property and put on flags and so forth. Again, my brother, Roger.
Okay, I will talk to him afterwards. But are you saying that there was notice ahead of time before Memorial Day, or was it just a physical confrontation at the cemetery on Memorial Day, if you know?
I don't know. Okay. I couldn't answer that.
I can answer that question.
Oh, you can? Sure.
Yes, Vicky, I can, sir. Memorial Day weekend, the Dovins sat at the cemetery all weekend long, just waiting for people to show up so they could take their pictures and they could video them, because they had private property and no trespassing signs. 28 of us showed up Memorial Day weekend and walked on that cemetery expecting to be arrested. But we went there to honor our veterans and our fathers. We all stood around and we sang Amazing Grace right around my father's cemetery, the tombstone. They stood there taking pictures and videos of us the whole time. And that's what they did. That's the kind of people they are. They sat there all weekend long. They were noticed there.
Before they allowed anybody to come in and put flags on graves, my daughter, she belongs to the Legion in Honeybrook, she talked to them and they, tried to give her some advice what to do. She's my kid and she's not going to take no for an answer, and I wouldn't either. We went over and she actually brought enough flags to put on every veteran's grave in that cemetery herself. She was there doing it the one morning, taking care of my dad's grave. My little 8-year-old grandson was with her. And the Dovins came up and took pictures of Jamie and our little grandson. And he said, "Mommy, why are they doing that?" And she said, "Honey, it's because we're here honoring Papa's grave," which is what my grandkids call my dad, is Papa. And he said, she said, he stood up proud and said, "Well, I hope they got a good picture of me because I love my Papa." And I wanted to say that.
Okay. Thank you. Does anybody have any idea how many graves have been sold and are awaiting someone to be buried in them? Are we talking 10? Are we talking 100? Do we have any idea?
Probably more closer to 20, because there was several people that were turned away.
Yeah.
There was, let's see, R4, 6, 7, and 8, and that's in our family. Plus there was Teleski, Shoemake, what was the name of the piece? Shoemate. And then another couple, a man that grew up near, well, he owned property across from my grandparents in Elverson. And he was denied burial. And it's like, wow, I didn't know he even died, but I was a kid growing up and knew he lived there.
But he said there are a substantial number of unused graves,
right,
that are awaiting burial. So this is a problem that's not going to go away for a long time unless the courts resolve it, or we are able to pass any legislation that might help ease the situation. Those of you who bought cemetery plots, did you buy it from the church itself? Did you buy it from the successors to the church?
How many
churches have been there? First, there's the Rock Church, and then there's the Rock Mennonite Church. I'm not so sure of the sequence. If anybody knows, could you tell us?
At least two different churches, plus there was another one that rented it for a time, but I'm sure they rented off of Harvey Kurtz. See, Harvey was the officer involved with the church, and he's the one that handled the prices and whatnot of the cemetery.
Okay, so he was like a manager for the church, but did he ever own the property, do you know?
What happened was Harvey Kurtz owned the property in the beginning. He sold the church property to the first church that showed up, because it was an outfit that also owned a quarry nearby in Elverson, a now defunct quarry. It was a family that cared about their workers, and they built the building for them and actually the cemetery, and that was for the workers it was a quarry.
Okay.
So then Harvey, he handled it for the church, and then he kept it, he also kept the building, he upkeep and inside work and whatever, and then the cemetery itself.
Okay, and when the church closed, did it simply move away and didn't, I mean, it wasn't, you know, like any kind of formal ceremony, it was just like one day they announced that at the end of the month we're not going to be here anymore?
Pretty much. They built another building and then they moved on. They had since changed their name as well. So.
Okay. Thank you very much. Thanks, Kerry.
Thank you, Chairman Hennessy. I just had one quick question. For those of you who have purchased any of the plots there at the time, did you receive any kind of deed, contract, or any kind of written documentation that basically told you what it was that you purchased and what that might entail as far as your rights?
No. At the time, we had receipts. Yeah. At the time, we just had receipts, because we never, and nobody ever had a question.
Because it was an active church.
It was an active church, so it wasn't a state matter. And now it becomes a state matter because it's no longer an active church. So we only ever had receipts, and then we were advised by certain lawyers, because our receipts never had a church name on them, that, oh, they might not be any good. I mean, all the Dovins say is, oh, they're all illegal. But, you know, this is 30 years ago when we didn't have to worry about thieves. This is a system of thievery where you're trying to steal from people their cemetery plots.
Tell her about the ledger.
And there was also a ledger, a book Harvey had kept for who bought, where they were to be buried. He had it strict detail in the book, and according to the neighbor behind the cemetery, he also saw a map on the wall. This was all turned over to the Dovins when they bought the place, and now they claim it's just gone. It disappeared.
Okay. I appreciate that. So most of it was kind of done on a gentleman's agreement, ledger's kept, but there's really no paperwork that said in this purchase you've got an X. I mean, especially if somebody buys several plots, it doesn't say the dimensions of it, what that means, what your obligations are. I mean, a lot of newer cemeteries have agreements that talk about perpetual care, and that's one of the reasons I put the second panel together, and we'll hear from them very shortly. I hopefully can kind of clarify. Your situation might be a little more unique because it's kind of been on a gentleman's handshake for years and tradition passed down, henceforth why you're in litigation, to do some search and discovery to try to determine that. And Mr. Jacobs?
Yes, I really can't comment, obviously, with respect to what I always knew as Rock Mennonite Church. I'm a member at Harmony Methodist Church, which is only a few miles away also. And my wife and I have twin sons buried there. We have no deed. We actually got the plot from my aunt and uncle, who decided that they would take a plot across the road and also in Harmony's new cemetery. But my wife and I have talked numerous times. We have nothing which says, this is your plot. Here are the dimensions. All we know is there's a headstone there which has our son's names on them. And it's our understanding that we have a plot or two next to them. So I suspect that what Rock Mennonite Church did, again, that's what I know it as, is certainly not unique with respect to how these kind of transactions take place.
Very good, and I appreciate the panel's testimony. I think before you dispatch, Representative Gillen had a couple questions.
I think at least one of our testifiers mentioned Southern accents, and I certainly enjoy them as I went to college in South Carolina. Kathy, I think you mentioned Virginia specifically, and I have pulled up a Virginia statute relative to access to cemeteries located on private property, and I'll just read a line out of it. Owners of private property in which a cemetery or graves are located shall have a duty to allow ingress, egress to the cemetery or graves by family members and descendants of deceased persons buried there. So I think based on the testimony that I'm hearing, you would be looking for something consistent with laws in other states that are explicitly stated, like a South Carolina or like a Virginia. And Virginia is even more elastic, and it allows for access to genealogical research. Now, House Bill 2228 doesn't go that far regarding the genealogy, but would allow for family members, defined by blood relatives, those that marry into a family or those that are adopted, reasonable access to the cemetery. Kathy, perhaps even Hazel or others, briefly react to what we have in the way of a legislative proposal allowing that kind of access.
I think that in order, you know, to visit my dad's grave, my uncle's graves, by marriage, but they're mine, and I love every one of them, my father-in-law, I would like to see everyone to be able to observe and participate in taking, you know, going to visit the graves without being videoed, without being pictures taken of me every time. Not that I'm pretty or anything, but I just don't want it. And I don't think anybody does. And you said in Virginia, in order to get to my grandmother's grave, we have to drive across the front lawn of a gentleman's yard. And we weren't going to do it. And he came out and asked, he said, are you here to see the cemetery? I said, yes, sir. He said, you drive right on up. He said, because that's the only way up there. And I just think that we should be allowed to visit. And I think that the ones that have graves there, plots, should be allowed to be buried there, like my mom and Hazel and Barb. Barb's been my best friend for years. And I just feel that it's a necessary thing to happen, that something needs to be done.
I am no attorney, but I did research briefly Pennsylvania case law, and certainly there's a belief amongst this panel that we need to beef up statutorily what's on the books. But it was Brown versus Lutheran Church, and it goes back many years. And I found instructive the line relative to what we all regard as sacred and hallowed ground. The resting place of the dead is hallowed ground, not subject to the laws of ordinary property. And certainly if somebody came onto your property, we would expect there'd be a right of exclusion. You can't be wandering around on my property. However, we're talking about the remains of loved ones. We're talking about graves. We're talking about crypts. And certainly it seems reasonable that there should be access to memorialize those individuals that are buried there. On page 10 of the civil action, and I think there was a reference to exhuming, I have to admit that it sent a certain chill up my spine when there was a discussion about granting a right of exhumation of those loved ones that you so emotionally described here. The state cannot right every wrong, and I don't often need tissues when I'm up front at one of these hearings, but today I could have used some. This panel, I think, has articulated that we're going to do everything within our power to make this right. One final brief question and word of clarification, because I had received information that the police were contacted by the family, and then I have some documentation saying that the police were never contacted by the family. And if you could just take a moment to clear that up. And I would say on behalf of the municipality and the police department, they're in a very difficult place. I know members of the board personally and spent time with the police officers. And certainly this is not what they wanted for their community. But relative to clearing up that difference, could somebody help me regarding the Dubbins family actually contacting the police department?
I can tell you of one incident. My niece went over to see my father's grave, her grandfather's grave, on Veterans Day. And she took a little flag to put on Dad's grave. And the Dubbins were there. And they called the police on her, and they came. And luckily that day, the police said she has every right to observe, to visit with her grandfather's grave on Veterans Day. And now, me personally, I've never had the law called on me. But I know Bill has.
Okay, well, I think we've essentially got an answer to that question, and we've gone over time, but every word was necessary for this panel to hear. We're extraordinarily grateful. Thank you for pouring your heart into this cause, not only on the behalf of your family, but for the community, and indeed the Commonwealth of Pennsylvania has an investment in making sure that this sacred ground remains hallowed. Mr. Chairman.
Thank you, Representative Gillen. And on behalf of our panel, we want to thank you for taking time to testify with us. You're welcome to have a seat as we pull up the next panel and listen to the rest of the hearing. We are going to be joined by Frank Grabozik from the Pennsylvania Cemetery Cremation and Funeral Directors Association, Beth Allman, Hartman Valenero, and McGovern and Lutz, as well as Les Rohrbach from the Berks County Association for Graveyard Preservation, and also joining him is Ann Wagner. The goal is to try to have a little bit better understanding of the governance of burial lots and burial property. As we get this panel ready, we'll get our seats in. As with the first panel, I'm going to ask our panelists to all give their testimony, and then the members will ask questions in order. I'm going to start with Frank Grabowski with the Cremations Funeral Directors Association. I think it helped give a little bit overview. As I stated earlier, it was my experience as county coroner that a lot of our laws, or lack thereof, are somewhat antiquated, including whether or not people can bury on their own property, and so a lot of these are case by case, so we're anxious to hear what you have to say, and then we'll go down the line to Beth, Les, and Ann. Thank you very much. Keep the microphone close when the light's on, it's green, and you're ready to go.
Thank you, and thank you for inviting me here today. My name is Frank Grabowski. I own Schuylkill Memorial Park, which is a cemetery in Schuylkill County. I'm a licensed funeral director in Schuylkill County. I am also on the board of directors of Pennsylvania Cemetery Cremation Funeral Association, and I am currently a vice president. I was asked to come here by our consumer affairs chairman on a fairly short notice, so I will defer to some of the facts that you may know and I may not know. As I have listened to the testimony here this morning and have learned a little bit about the situation, I am a little bit puzzled how we have gotten to this point. The owner of the property that contains the cemetery certainly is not acting as a cemeterian. He seems to be a person who owns the property, but does not want to take care of it as a cemetery. It is a cemetery, has been a cemetery, and when someone buys a cemetery, whether he intends to or not, he buys the obligations that is associated with the cemetery. When you buy a what people call a plot, you're actually buying a right of interment. You're buying the right to be buried on that specific plot with the subject to the rules and regulations of the cemetery. In this case, I don't know if there are any rules and regulations at the cemetery. The owner does not seem to even acknowledge that a cemetery exists, and therein lies, you know, the biggest problem. When we have a dispute like this or a question like this, and we're asked to get involved as an association, The normal course of events is we would speak to people on both sides of the issue. I notice there is no one here from the owner's side, which is very strange. So it's very hard to get the owner's perspective as to why he is doing what he is doing. After listening to the testimony, it's hard to have much sympathy for the owner, and I think that's been obvious by not only the testimony but by the comments of the panel. As far as ideas on how to rectify the situation, there are remedies, I think, in law that exist. Number one, contract law. These people have been sold a right of interment either through the cemetery or by a cemetery representative that shows that they have the right of interment to a specific grave. Number two, the owner is acting as though he's actually abandoning the cemetery. He's not doing what normally would have to be done to take care of a cemetery. So he seems to have abandoned his rights as far as ownership of the cemetery itself, if not the land. So there are certain things also. The statute in the past, I know, has addressed the right of access to cemeteries. I'm not an attorney, so I can't cite a specific statute, but I know one had existed. So under all these statutes, it seems to me that we have remedies, remedies that would be quicker and certainly more effective than trying to pass a law that states the obvious. You have a right to be interred on a cemetery plot that you own, and you have the right to visit a grave that someone is buried on. So, you know, it seems to me that there are remedies that already exist here, and I think if we could even start at the magisterial level, I'm sure the township has a solicitor that would be able to acknowledge the laws that do exist and give these people you know, the relief that they deserve and give it to them quickly. That's my take on what I see here at first glance. I'd be glad to answer any questions if anyone has any after all the testimony has been completed.
Thank you, Mr. Grabozik. Just for editorial note, this is, I want to make sure people in here and outside here realize that this is not a trial. We're not trying to get evidence on both sides. We're basically listening about an issue that, one, is not necessarily isolated only to Berks. Representative Gillen was gracious enough to have us here, but is happening statewide. But I think it's important. We're not here to adjudicate the pros and cons of both sides. And so we're very careful as we do fact-finding as a policy chair. From your perspective, Mr. Grabozik, just real quickly, if I were to come into your facility, kind of walk me through what my expectation would be. That might give us a better idea. If we came to your cemetery and I was going to buy a plot tomorrow, what is current expectation? I mean, unfortunately, we're dealing with stuff that happened in decades and decades ago, which will be adjudicated throughout the trial, but we want to understand what current cemetery expectations are if I came into your facility.
Generally, when you purchase a right of interment, there's a contract that states what you are buying, where you are buying it. After it's paid, you would receive a deed that is not a deed of ownership of the land. It's a deed of a right of interment, which is what you get when you. As far as access goes, anyone who wants to walk through a cemetery, subject to general rules, you can't come at night. If there's an existing service going on, people know to stay away until the service is over, common sense type things. But generally, the cemetery is open to anyone to come in. If we do a genealogy, no one is restricted from coming in the cemetery unless there is an obvious reason. The people are usually there because they want to visit a grave. They want to do some genealogy work. So these things are normal. I don't know if you're looking for any specific.
No, that's type helpful. I appreciate that.
Mm-hmm.
Beth, you would like to join us?
Is it on? No. Is that on? Yes, it is. Okay, thanks. Good morning. My name is Beth Allman. I am an attorney with the law firm of Hartman, Valeriano, McGovern, and Lutz. We're located in Wyomissing, Berks County. I'd like to thank the representatives for inviting us here today to be part of this panel. Our law firm handles a wide variety of civil matters, specifically doing a good bit of real estate, land use, and municipal law, which are all things that come into play in this situation. A few months ago, we were contacted by the group of residents that comprise the panel that sat prior to this panel and their brethren, so to speak, to deal with this matter. Again, this sounds complicated, and it is. As we started to delve into this, we discovered quickly that Pennsylvania laws that govern these issues are very old. They're unclear, or in some cases, non-existent. As you might suspect, we initially turned to a review of the statutes on these issues. There are a number of acts that have been passed that are out there, starting back in the 1840s all the way through updates in the 1990s. So it isn't all completely old, but a lot of this sort of controlling law is. Those address things in terms of the procedure for licensing and operation of modern cemeteries, creating the perpetual care funds that were mentioned earlier, and dealing with, circumstances under which bodies can be removed and reburied elsewhere. I think the summary of the issue here in Carnarvon deals with two issues, and one is that right of burial for these plots that were purchased at some point in time, and the residents having that desire to, act upon that. And then second, this access piece, which is sort of, I think, in our society and historically viewed as a given. Mr. Grabowski said it's common sense. I think most people just assume that you can do that. You've referenced a statute. We have not identified anything that really concretely allows access for these people to grave sites that exist. Under the statutes, there are a number of laws. There was a mention, I think Representative Knowles made a comment that, he's dealt with properties where, a road cannot go through because it's a cemetery. That is a statute that's on the books. That came to be in 1849. There's statutes that provide for a limited class of owners, including churches and religious societies and burial associations, to have the ability to remove and rebury elsewhere bodies in a limited number of scenarios, such as issues related to public health, if a cemetery has in fact been neglected, if there's, some type of higher governmental purpose, something that looks like eminent domain, but there, at least the government takes the initiative to help, rebury at a more suitable location. That obviously would be an emotional situation, but that, you know, would be a burden that would be on the owners of the land as that religious type of organization. That's not where we are here with this private owner. You know, similarly, there are statutes to deal with abandoned and neglected cemeteries. You know, there's question here as to whether the actions that have been taken would rise to abandonment. It's not that old. People were buried here 6 years ago. To argue that this cemetery has been abandoned is, you know, questionable, I would say. Is it neglected? Not really. It was mowed as of, you know, several months ago. So it's not one of these historical cemeteries that has no current action. You know, there's preservation, which I'm sure my colleagues to my left will talk to you about. There's acts that protect historical graveyards, but there's provisions, from my understanding, that say that some of that law only applies if no one's been buried there in the past 50 years, which isn't the situation either. You know, as attorneys in my firm, we're new to this, so the people on either side of me are probably better versed in sort of the scope and the day-to-day graveyard operations and preservation issues. But from our review of the law in this situation, we've found that there really appears to be a void on the statute basis. So, you know, we then move to look at case law. And the majority of the case law here is also very old. There is some case law that talks about the sale of burial grounds and says that you can't do it without a statute that allows you to do it, but it doesn't really say what happens if you do, and here that happened. So we have private ownership that, you know, potentially there's some question, but there's no clear remedy. Sort of secondly, to the issue of what does a cemetery plot mean? As I think some of the representatives have mentioned, and Mr. Grabowski, you know, today I think most cemeteries that are actively selling plots have some kind of agreement. You know, there is definitely an argument that that is a issue of contract law. What that plot means, how it runs with the land, if it runs with the land, are all questions. The case law that's addressed those issues talks about burial plots as being a license of sorts, which is sort of a limited right. Different cases have addressed it a little differently, but there's an issue of it's from that, you know, if the current church sells a plot to someone, there is no case law that really clearly says what that license means, whether that person that owns a right to bury still has that right when someone else owns the property. It hasn't been addressed and flushed out through the courts in any clear and meaningful manner which these people can rely upon. You know, the most relevant situation, you know, most relevant, I think, to this situation and probably to the state at large is this right of access. The right of burial seems meaningless to some extent if people don't have the right to visit the graves. I think that's why we're here in a large part. Many of those old cases make reference to the rights of cemeteries to make reasonable regulations, such as hours of access. They also describe, you know, the use of such cemeteries, and the cases mention people visiting graves, placing flowers and mementos. But none of them actually revolve around whether that right exists, and so they don't create conclusive kind of case law on which to rely in saying that right does exist. You know, it basically appears to be taken for granted as a given. Some of those old case laws cite the Bible. They cite Greek mythology. They cite, you know, Shakespeare talking about, you know, life and death and visiting of graves, that it just seems like something that we assume is a given when someone dies. And I think you saw that from the panel that testified previously. You know, I don't want to get into all of the nuance and the validity of their arguments obviously there is pending litigation. But basically, I mean, from our perspective, there's nothing in our laws today that require the owner of the cemetery, whether that's a private individual or, quite frankly, even a religious institution, to, if they so choose, prohibit access. I think it's one of these things where, you know, historically, the church took it upon itself to serve this function in society, and it did so well, and people never questioned that as being something that would always be there. And so we now are in a position where, you know, churches have died and we have private owners, and there are a lot of questions that are left unanswered. So I think that's, you know, there's a couple other things that maybe I can chime in on through some of the discussion, but that's kind of the framework that we've looked at in terms of the law, where it stands today, in my statement.
I appreciate that, and you kind of codified my mind that the whole issue is still very vague and that the laws are very antiquated to some extent, or at least need updated. Mr. Rohrbaugh and Ms. Wagner, if you'd like to share on behalf of the preservation organization, we'd appreciate that.
I'll just describe a little bit about what we do. We're sort of dealing with historic graveyards, which by Pennsylvania law have been in existence for more than 100 years. There are no burials for the last 50 years, and there are no future burials expected there. So we're dealing, our knowledge really, it's maybe what these folks might be dealing with down the road, but right now we're dealing with older stuff. So we focus pretty much on the graveyards where there are physical remains. So we have tombstones, stone walls. There's lots of graveyards where they had wooden markers just buried out back of somebody's house, and they're long gone. We don't really address those. We try to keep the graveyards in some state of repair, but we'll go in and do maintenance maybe once a year. To the extent that we have money, we will try to rebuild walls or repair walls. The graveyards that we access, and again, these are private family graveyards. They're not, you know, but they may have been 200 years ago a community graveyard for some little hamlet possibly. So the graveyards are often located out in fields, in woods, not necessarily easily accessible. They can be surrounded by crops. It's not unusual, so we have to schedule our activities when the crops aren't in the fields, because, again, we're just working with the goodwill of the landowners, and we don't want to, you know, we're not interested in antagonizing them. We're just trying to keep the graveyards and from being totally run over. And most property owners are respectful, they're cooperative, they try to help us out. And we just talk to them. There's no legal requirements or any legal issues really raised with them. You know, just, you know, when can we go in there? Is there a place where we can dump the debris that we collect if we're cutting stuff down? But legally, there's a great variety of what exists. Some of the graveyards are accepted from deed, so the property around them is sold, but the graveyard itself is not. They're separate. Sometimes deeds specify easements, or they specify burial rights for certain descendants, generally the people who are, who last own it, who sell it out of the family, so to speak. But there's a big question of, you know, whatever they did they record that? Because what we find is that after two or three generations, after the family itself moves away, their descendants lose sight of the fact that they may be descended from that family or that the graveyard's even there. So there's, it's not too long historically before people lose track of things. We've seen where rights are granted to family associations, and the family associations can't be found today. And like I said, there are descendants who get rights. They move away. They can't be found. We found one recently in Minnesota, about apparently the only one left of the series of people who were granted rights in one deed. They knew nothing about it. All right. And we fortunately have a member who likes to research deeds, and Berks County is at least, it's easy to, from home over the internet, research deeds. So the best that we can find information in deeds, we try to find it. Our issues are just, like, there are about four things we run into. We've had deeds where there are easements recorded that permitted access to the graveyard, and it specified certain months of the year when wagons would be allowed in, which tells you how old some of this stuff goes back. But we've had the landowners deny us access, not just us, anyone. So there's a period of possibly 20 years where the trees took off. It was very overgrown, and eventually we were allowed to get in there, and you know, we did cut the trees down and restore the walls. Sometimes, like I say, we try to work with the families that own the land around it that we have to go through, but sometimes they're not real happy that we're there, so they sort of hide from us as best they can. You can't call them on the phone. We have a case where we have to drive around the roads to see if we can find the farmer in his field to walk out to talk to him to get permission, or when is a suitable time to go into a graveyard. We've had the very old graveyards, a lot of times you'll see tombstones scattered around with lots of empty spaces. Sometimes the tombstones are clustered in one section of the graveyard. And my speculation on that is just that most of the people buried there had wooden markers or something that are long gone after a couple hundred years. So I've had a farmer argue with me that he should be allowed to plow one section of what has historically been thought to be the graveyard, because nobody's gone in there, nobody's plowed there for 150, 200 years, the trees are there. But in his, in his farm field of hundreds of acres, he wants to take a little bit larger plot of the graveyard because there are no tombstones there. Another issue we have is Pennsylvania law defines historic graveyards. We have people who own the land who talk about they'd like to be buried there, someplace where there are no tombstones. And if that happens, then the graveyard loses its historic designation. And our feeling is that if this graveyard's been here for a couple hundred years, it's probably full, and it's probably buried full at least. So we don't, we're against that, I guess. We don't support that. But again, we're relatively small nonprofit. We have some income from a trust that was given, that was created for us, but we're not going to spend money fighting legal issues. We're just going to, there are too many graveyards that need work. We'll just go where we can get do something done and accomplish something. So thank you.
Thank you very much for your testimony, Ms. Wagner.
Okay, this is kind of like better than Christmas for me today. For the last 8 years that I've been a member on the board of this group, I've talked to pretty much every legislator that I could get a hold of until I finally gave up. We met with Jody Schwank a couple years ago. I have had long conversations with Tom Calder-Jerome. One time he conference called me with a retired judge. I can't remember his name. I've talked to any lawyer that I ran into, you know, just off the cuff. And I've been researching the graveyard laws for a long time. They're vague. They're all over the place. You can't find them in one place. You should be able to go to Google and type in Pennsylvania cemetery laws, and everything pertaining should come up. It does not. What you find are the old laws, the ones with the revisions. You don't find anything dealing with contracts. You find nothing dealing with access. Access is important. This is not the only church that went defunct. There are so many. I have a folder, nice size folder, on my computer of churches. They're no longer in business, but there's cemeteries there. Neighbors take care of them. Anybody who feels like it takes care of them. Now, we generally don't get into the big church cemeteries. We're busy with the ones in the farmer's field. A couple years ago, the day Bin Laden was killed, my son called me and said, Mom, did you see the paper? Bin Laden was killed. I said, oh, great. And he said, and guess what? You're on the front page, too, and your picture's bigger than him. That was the day the Reading Eagle ran the story about the Heckler Esterly burial ground in Exeter Township. In 1976, girls from Albright tried to put flags on those graves. The woman who owns the property, allegedly, because I wasn't there, pulled a shotgun to make them leave. Years later, one of the members of our board now, who is the stonemason that does the amazing work that you see in our newsletters, he tried to access it. Same thing. She pulled a shotgun. Police were called over the years. Family members went to the Exeter Police Department. All kinds of things were tried to gain access to this burial ground. Finally, we found in the Recorder of Deeds office this little tiny easement to the cemetery. Basically, it was saying that the Esterly Family Association and their friends have access to this burial ground. Well, once we had that, they still weren't given in. We went to the county. We found out that the county commissioners have this little known law that says if there's a veteran in that cemetery, they are the keeper of last resort. They would have been responsible for that cemetery had we not been able to get in there. Their lawyer contacted their lawyer. It went back and forth. Needless to say, we got in, but they made it the roughest way we could possibly get in. We spent about $40,000 fixing those walls, and we put that one back together. That's not the only one. You know, we have others where the farmers will deliberately block us out with the crops. We can't get into work on them. You know, I feel they should be responsible for any damages being caused through their refusal to let anybody in, but that's a whole different story. Pennsylvania still allows burials in your backyard. We don't think it's a great idea, and we wish somebody would look at that one day too. But there are a lot of cemeteries that are going under. Albany Township has several where the owner's unclear. A lot of these cemeteries really are orphans. The one over there by the museum, the Barnhart Adams, our deed researcher spent countless hours and determined it is an orphan, it has no legal owner. Various people take care of it. You know, what happens to these cemeteries when nobody owns them? What we're doing, we're kind of in a gray area. I mean, we don't know who really legally owns these cemeteries. They're all different. Some have owners, some don't. Some are accepted from the deeds, but there's still no owner for the cemetery. We've had access issues for years and years and years. So we kind of just, you know, work with who we can. I'm glad to see that Barry's here because the last time I saw him, I mentioned the access issues. Every time I get a chance, I mention it to somebody because nobody knows what to do. The laws stink. We've giggled already about how we were going to get into a graveyard by using the existing law that says if you get 25 people in a 5-mile radius of the cemetery to petition the court, They will order the township to take care of that, and it will then become public. They can only spend $30 a year. This was a 1929 law. How are we going to find 25 people in a 5-mile radius of a cemetery in Ole? That was the question. The laws, they're bad. Now, Tennessee laws, they know what they're talking about. If you look at the ones from Tennessee, they use very clear language. They basically say, if you bought a cemetery, if you bought land with a cemetery, there's an implied easement. Implied easement, I've heard that 100 times over the last 8 years. Nobody ever thought anybody would have to deliberately tell somebody, that's a cemetery, you have to let somebody in there. It's just unthinkable. And most of the time, it's not an issue. But it is becoming an issue more and more, especially as these cemeteries go under. There is a man, and I haven't been able to get him from any further information, in another area of Pennsylvania. It was in the Scranton Times Tribune. Robert Vail in Lackawanna County actually did start a lawsuit against a property owner to gain access. Maybe you guys can find out what happened with that. But every lawyer that I've spoken to said if anything actually would come to court, they would always side with the person wanting to visit the grave. But who's going to do it? Who's going to take people to court and who's going to enforce it? You know, we have these laws that say you can't remove tombstones, you can't do all these things. Nobody enforces it. You call the police. I can't tell you how many phone calls I've had from people. They call the police and they say it's not our problem. It's a civil matter. You got to go to court. Nobody has time for that. Nobody has money for that. What I would like to see you do, I did look at the bill that you proposed, and it only mentions family members, which is going to be a problem for a lot of them. But it's a start. I would love to have you look over the whole thing, work on what's already there, do the modifications and the revisions, and come up with something that's clear, no vagueness, that you can hand it to someone and say, look, this is the law, you know? It would make our life a lot easier. You know, we're working on about 150 cemeteries in Berks County. That's just Berks County, they're everywhere. So we could use some help. I mean, I've been begging for it for years, and nobody's been able to come up with something, you know, to give some relief. Hopefully, you know, I told right off the bat, I said, you're going to need a lawyer. It's a tangled web, and I'm glad they found you.
Very good. So, we appreciate your testimony, all four of you. I think we'll start questions from my left, starting with Representative Jerry Knowles and Representative Stan Saylor.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. I'm getting some mixed vibes here. I'm a little confused, and I've been doing my best to pay attention. I sometimes think we have too many we make too many new laws. Okay, I don't want to see any law made just for the sake of making a law. And I believe that Representative Gillen is on to something here in terms of this legislation. But Frank, you said something. My question is, if there's a law in the book, or if we create a new law, if it's not enforced, if somebody's gonna thumb their nose at that law, you're gonna end up in litigation, you're gonna end up in court. And my question, and I think Frank and Beth, do we have laws on the book to prevent what's happening here? It sounds to me, Frank, from what you said, that we already do, and then I'm hearing that we don't.
I think we're. I think we're looking at it, you know, from two different perspectives. We're looking at a local issue, a specific issue, that we would hope we would be able to get a remedy for as quickly as possible. And also, we're looking, as we heard testimony on, the larger issue of older cemeteries that have either been abandoned, been neglected, no one knows anything about. I think that's an issue unto itself. So yes, there are issues there that need to be clarified in the statute.
When we're looking at this issue that brings us all here today, I think there are existing laws that these people can get remedy pretty quickly. I mean, I'm no lawyer, but I would think that either a lawyer for these people, you know, that have been aggrieved, or a solicitor would be able to go to a magistrate and say, hey, we have a contract here. These people bought an interment right. They should be able to use it. That should be, at least in my mind, maybe I'm not looking at it, you know, from a lawyer's perspective, but from just from being a cemetery owner, if someone wants to be buried where they have a deed or a contract for an interment right, that should be a no-brainer. They should be able to be buried there. If someone wants to visit a grave, inherent in the ownership of a cemetery is the right for people to visit graves. That has been common for as long as I've been involved in the business, and you know, it's been over 30 years. So I think looking at it from a perspective of the case that we're dealing with today, I think we do have remedies. Looking at it from the overall perspective as to what the laws state about older cemeteries in general, yes, I think the laws could be clarified there. So, you know, I think you have two different perspectives here.
Thank you, Mr. Trump.
Just to respond to those comments, I'm not sure I entirely agree. Not that that's going to help your situation as legislators looking at whether we need laws in this issue. The issue, I do agree with Frank to some extent that in this situation, whether what these individuals hold in terms of plots is a contract issue. Looking at what is out there in the law that says what a cemetery plot means, that is gray, especially looking at historical plots. Currently, there are current modern laws that govern cemeteries, but they apply to cemetery associations as a defined term, which is entities that are currently selling cemetery plots. So where you have active cemetery operations, there is in fact a framework by which that cemetery must operate, provides for, you know, what it needs to look like, funding to be provided when plots are sold for perpetual care, those types of issues. Now those statutes don't actually, again, really clarify what a plot when sold means. There has been some case law, as I mentioned, that addresses that, but if it's not in the contract, there's questions. And that is, in fact, where these folks are. And is that something that in this situation may be best left to the courts? Perhaps. But I think there are other situations. I've been told by my mom that I'm a land baron because, you know, my mom's an only child and my brother lives across the country, so I'm going to get 12 cemetery plots scattered about Berks County that go back many generations. Are all of those, you know, contracts the way they would be done today, or may some of those be less formal? I honestly don't know. I just have an understanding that they exist. And so I think there may be some space in the law to clarify what these things look like. I do think that going forward, however, you know, I think that everyone that is currently in the cemetery business has wised up. You know, it is 2016. People are making much more deliberate contracts for these types of things going forward. But looking backwards, there are a lot of questions. With regard to the access rights, Mr. Grabowski did show me some statute. I don't know what it is. There is regarding some type of public access. I believe that is related to cemetery associations again, which, or excuse me, to church associations. And so I'm not sure that that provides any protection in this private cemetery context where you don't have a property owner that is really in the business of cemeterying or whatever the term is as it's defined under the law. And that's where these people fall kind of in this situation. And as Anne has described, that's a problem that's growing across our state because more and more cemeteries once owned by churches and probably covered by those laws are now falling into this private ownership where there's a void of clarity in terms of what that means. And so what may be sort of, you know, an inherent assumption that visitation will happen, when it actually comes down to fighting to enforce that, you now have people whose loved ones are buried that want to visit graves, and they have to go to court and battle, and there's no clear law for them to point to. You know, the court battle would be much shorter if they can say, here is the statute that our legislature passed that said I have an absolute right to come do this, at least at reasonable times, dusk to dawn, you know, something of that nature. Now it's a big question mark, and if you have a difficult property owner, as it appears we may have here, who's willing to spend money and fight, these people may be fighting for a very long time with a lot of money, which is not the solution that I think, you know, we want here or elsewhere.
Thank you to the testifiers, and thank you, Mr. Chairman.
Can I add, the other issue, for a cemetery that doesn't want to be active, but there's still plots, they're in a gray area too, because they would still technically qualify where they would have to do the escrow to be an active cemetery. And if there would be some clarification that would say if they're not going to sell new plots, they still must honor the previously sold plots, I think that would put them in a better light as far as feeling comfortable legally allowing those burials that have already been accounted for.
If I could interject a question briefly, because we've heard some terminology, cemetery business, old cemetery, historic cemetery. As reported in the August the 11th, which had been 2 months ago today, edition of the Reading Eagle, the Labs Funeral Home walked the Dovens through a funeral, and so on their watch, under their ownership, someone was interred in the cemetery. What does that do to the discussions about old, historic, whether in the cemetery business or not, since the Dovens family oversighted a burial in the cemetery when they owned the cemetery?
That's a good question.
My understanding under sort of Title IX, which governs cemeteries, is that because the current owners have not actually accepted money and sold new plots, that those rules sort of governing operation do not apply to them, and that I don't believe that the burying of someone during their ownership changes that as long as they were not selling cemetery plots.
Thank you very much. As you see, our discussion continues to make things a little bit cloudier than they were when we started. Just for comment, too, I think sometimes we get interchanging comment, I mean, words like laws, statutes, versus what's been common practices and traditions. And I think we have to be careful not classifying everything as formal laws unless we know indeed that they were a statute or a law. I think my next question comes from Representative Stan Saylor, then Representative Hennessy.
Thank you, Anne, for your passion, by the way. Again, Frank, I thank you, because I think what you said here today is exactly what Pennsylvanians, probably everybody in the United States, thinks is really the way cemeteries are to be. And I guess my question really is to you, Beth, who's an attorney, and I come from the old school as a farm boy, and common sense should have the rule. And I realize that isn't all the way it is in courts, but to me, the practice that Frank cited here today, does that have no bearing in the court? And why is this case something that's not before the Berks County Court of Common Pleas on a rather rapid approach? This is something that's very heart-wrenching and everything else, but to me, this is the kind of a case and why the justice system doesn't work when you can't get justice quickly. I mean, if this takes 10 years to resolve, this is what is wrong with our legal system. So I guess my question to you is, what part does what Frank said play out in the court as the common practice of today and even of the past, really. I mean, I understand what Les and Ann stated as far as old cemeteries where there is no ownership, but there is an ownership here who's identified. So why does the courts, or would not the courts, act quickly to make sure that people's rights are not denied in a case where you have an owner? Why is what Frank's saying, or is what Frank's saying, going to play a major part in this?
I think that on the ownership of the plots issue as sort of a contract type issue, the court can flush that issue out. As far as the access, I think is where the law gets grayer. I mean, in law in general, there's an interest in protecting sort of the alienable fee estate, which is if I go buy real estate, unless there's something that concretely sort of in writing encumbers that and runs with the land sort of as a, I don't want to talk like a lawyer at you, but, you know, if I go buy property and there's nothing that clearly establishes that somebody else has a right and tells me what those rights are, then I should have the right to use that property as I see fit. For whatever purpose. I mean, obviously, you know, kind of we look at real estate as a variety of rights all wrapped together, but there's nothing in the law that clearly states that the fact that a cemetery is located on real estate carries with it some burden on a future landowner.
But Pennsylvania's Constitution is very clear. In fact, we even as a legislature cannot break contracts. The Constitution strictly forbids the legislature or anybody from breaking a contract unless there's a showing of, lying, things like that, that are, you as an attorney would have a better words for those things. So to me, these people have a contract. It might not be written out all the things in it, but it's a contract that they purchased a property. And so why is that contract not something that is immediately enforceable by the courts? Because it is in the Constitution.
I think in this situation, the terms of there is a question as to the contracts because the history and the way this situation played out is gray. It was not, Harvey sold everyone a plot and they have receipts, and what that exactly entails is going to be a question for the court. I do think the courts are probably the proper place for that issue to be resolved. What I was saying was sort of on the access piece. I think that there's nothing, for Hazel has a contract, arguably. She has a headstone with her name on it. But these people's children never sat there, shook hands, and got a receipt from someone. They don't necessarily have a contract. Does the contractual rights of Hazel in buying that plot guarantee rights through that contract to every one of her children?
But Beth, the question is, I guess, I know where you're going there, but the question I have is, these people have a receipt for buying a plot.
Yes.
That's a contract.
Arguably.
Okay. Common sense, again, maybe that doesn't play out in the law like I think it should. Mm-hmm. Common sense says that's a contract that I can be buried there. When I buy a piece of land, and I have a receipt, a bill of sale, mm-hmm. that says I can be buried there. So, you're right. You're not really buying the land. You're buying the right to be buried on that piece of land.
Right.
So how can the courts rule that any number of the people who have that contract not be buried there? They may not have the right to mow it. Maybe they don't even have the right under current law to put flowers there or a flag, although I think the law on the flags is pretty clear. The county, they do have that right. But, you know, what are the courts, how is the courts looking at this whole process because of what Frank said and because of the contractual law of the Pennsylvania Pennsylvania Constitution? And then thank you, Mr. Chairman.
Well, I mean, in this situation, the issue really has not been before the court. The litigation is in early stages, so the court has not taken action with regard to this dispute yet. We're progressing in that direction. However, the courts, in making their decision, are going to have to rely on the body of existing law, which is, in fact, vague. I mean, I think I like at my core to also think that the court's going to do the right thing here. And I hope for everyone that sat here that, there's going to be tears of joy one day when they get, confirmation that they have the right to bury those people. but it still is the court having to rely upon laws that are very vague and very unclear.
This isn't the only place that this is happening. I mean, Pennsylvania cemetery laws leave some seeking clarity. I mean, these articles pop up every other year, you know, somebody else fighting with some cemetery, you know, over the vagueness. Back here, you can have that if you.
Well, that is our primary reason for being here, and you folks are providing some very good information. I think the counselor says it pretty well. You know, the courts are going to adjudicate with what current law is. We can talk about prospective law changes to try to help people be able to secure their rights for access. I think Representative Hennessy had a question.
I do. Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Ms. Wagner, you had mentioned a Lackawanna County case. Is it Robert Vail?
Mm-hmm.
V-A-L-E?
V-A-I-L.
V-A-I-L, okay.
Yeah.
If you have any information on that, could you get it to us and we can get it around to the other members? Thank you. Do you need this back? Okay.
I was going to give it to Beth in case she could use it.
Okay.
It might open, like, see what their lawyer found out till it was all said and done. Okay. I haven't been able to locate him. Normally, I try to reach out to these people and keep tabs, but I haven't been able to locate him.
So you don't know how that was resolved, if it's been resolved at all yet?
Right.
Okay. Then I have a question for Mr. Rohrbach, who happens to have the burden of being my next door neighbor down in Chester County.
How high is the fence?
Luckily, after 40, how long have you been there? 38 years, you haven't erected a fence. So I guess we have a pretty nice neighborhood. But if we, I will say that if the Berks County Society here for preservation, graveyard preservation, if he takes care of the graveyards as well as he takes care of his own lawn, they're probably pristine. He puts a burden on me to try to keep up, and I can't keep up because he takes care of his property very, very well. You had mentioned, Les, that some people do some research from their homes in terms of, title searches, deed searches, whatever. Do you know whether or not anybody in your association has done one specifically with regard to this plot of ground?
Or yes.
Is that, you have?
Yes, Betty and I were looking at it. We started looking at it. I will bet you she finished, but
okay.
I didn't.
Well, you know, can you talk to her and see whether or not we can? It would be helpful just to know the history of the churches, how they were designated, whether they those churches, whether there's any members of those churches that could even give us information about how things
were
handled.
We flew some email back and forth the night that that people were emailing us about it. And we started to look at it, and I think one of the questions that we had was, according to Pennsylvania law, to operate the cemetery, were those plots sold legally with a perpetual care fund? And the law is kind of vague on that as well, because it talks about if you are a church association or coming from a church association, you didn't need that perpetual care, but did the next person need it? And that's one of the questions I think you're going to be looking at, were the plots sold legally with a perpetual care fund.
Well, if you could check with whoever it was that was doing these searches, if you could get copies of that to us, it would be helpful just in terms of understanding the history of it. You know, and quite frankly, in defense of legislatures going back hundreds of years, the law sort of assumes that people will act rationally, and we pass statutes to make sure that they do and to prevent them from stepping too far astray. But something like this, something like the idea of looking at a piece of ground, seeing headstones all over and saying, well, gee, I didn't know it was a cemetery and I didn't know that people might want to come on to visit graves, makes absolutely no sense in my mind. But I don't know how prior legislatures could have ever anticipated that kind of craziness.
Yeah. Oh, it's amazing. I mean, we never thought in a million years that anybody would say, no, you can't come see the cemetery. Like, people just don't do that.
Yes. Thank you very much for your testimony, both you and the prior panel. It's been helpful to us. Thank you very much.
We're going to have Representative Gillen's going to close us out. I just want to say thank you. Oops. Thank you. He's in a hurry to do so. I just wanted to thank the township also for allowing us to use your facility, to our audiovisual crew who does a great job of providing us information, not only to us here in the room, but to our members out that are not able to join us. To the testifiers, to the audience for being here, this is really a a great example of how the democratic process works. We have differences in our society. We're always going to have differing opinions, and hopefully we can find amicable solutions by having discussion of facts and ideas. I think this eventually is going to work itself out, and even with the Dovins, who purchased it properly, legally, and we have to work within the confines of the current law, and there's going to be legislative changes that need to be done, we will do our best to do that. But I want to thank you for taking time to be here. That's really how the process works, and thank Representative Gillen for helping us set that up.
Thank you very much, Mr. Chairman. Thank you, Baroness Almond, especially, owns many plots. Just a couple thoughts as we close. Thank you, panelists, and the community for sharing your heart, your tears. Thank you for how you're mutually supporting, whether you have a plot you've purchased or whether you have a family member that's buried in the cemetery. This situation touches everybody in the Commonwealth. I had a conversation with my 90-year-old mother relative to where she'd like to be buried, quite isolated from the larger discourse here, and she's picked out a spot. She's already secured it, and as you would expect, it's next to another family member. And I thought about what she purchased and what her expectations were in the context of what we have going on here. And I believe it's sacred ground. I believe it's hallowed ground. And we're going to do everything we can as legislators to clarify the law. And I think we have a primary responsibility there. And I would see legislation that I've initiated as being a starting point and not a finished product to solve all that ails this apparently antiquated system. I will say in closing that our office sent a certified letter to the Dovins. I have a copy of that letter, and I have a copy acknowledging that they received the letter. And the attorney representing the Dovins indicated that they would not be making any public statements at this hearing. And so the committee, under the able guidance of the chairman, has done everything that it could to hear all perspectives. The committee is going to head out to the cemetery, and we're just going to take a look at it from the roadside there, so it helps us to quantify a little bit better. We've seen pictures. Certainly I've been out to the cemetery, but other members of the committee, as far as I know, have not been out to the cemetery. We'll be parked on the roadside there, and then we'll take a look at that. And if you feel it's important for you to be out there, that's fine. It's not necessary. It's not a part of the hearing. So God bless you, and thank you for being here. The hearing is now concluded.
Thank you.